About the main intention of this book, his thoughts, desires, hopes, expectations regarding its destiny in the world of film criticism, philosophy of art, and general public. So please welcome Professor Eldridge.
Thanks to Pierre Keller and to Helmut Waldeschul for organizing this session, and to Alina Fell for her introductory remarks. And thanks to all of you present for taking an interest in this book and in the films of Werner Herzog. Above all, though, thanks to my five commentators, each of whom has done a terrific job in reading, thinking about, and raising questions for my book. We will have lots to talk about, and I expect to learn a lot, as indeed I already have. In thinking about how to introduce my book and its motivations and aims briefly, it occurred to me that I might, on this occasion, say a few words about Carl Jaspers. I am not a scholar of his work, as some of you are, but I have done some reading around in preparation for this session, and I have discovered five important affinities between Jaspers' thinking and my own, affinities that will come up in the discussion. First, there is a sense, shared by Jaspers and me, that there are questions about meaning, value, and the sense that life is worthwhile. About how to overcome nihilism, one might say. Questions that cannot be wholly or adequately addressed by the experimental natural sciences. Second, there is the sense that human life and subjective experience exist within nature and social life. No Cartesian dualism here. Third, there is the sense that numinous or emphatic experience might have powers of disclosure that aid us in achieving a sense of orientation and worth in life. Jaspers here took some interest in mystical experience, as Meister Eckhart and Nicholas of Cusa described it in this respect, while I have turned more to the experience of art. Curiously, as it happens, however, I wrote my own undergraduate history thesis on Eckhart and Nicholas. Fourth, there is a sense associated by Jaspers with Kierkegaard, and by me with Wordsworth, Hölderlin, and Wittgenstein, that human lives are marked by a kind of itinerant in having available no fixed arche from which finished doctrinal thought might proceed, and by openness to the possibility of numinous experience. Fifth, and finally, there is our shared sense that the overcoming of nihilism and the achievement of a sense of orientation and meaning in one's life are open processes that are not detached from the courses of history and sense experience. I'm grateful to the Carl Jaspers Society for having made me aware of all these affinities. About my book in particular, then. This book appears in a series conceived and edited by Kostika Bradatin called Philosophical Filmmakers. Mine is the second in the series. The first was on Eric Romer, and one just out is on Terrence Malick. A volume on Kenneth Lonergan will appear next month. The idea of the series was that a philosopher should write freely about how and why the work of an individual filmmaker has mattered to him or her. Graditan's compelling thoughts, I conjecture, were that this would open up a new, perhaps more humanist philosophical way of thinking about film, and second, enable philosophers to write what they cared about and what others might care about more freely and less under the constraints of professional protocols than they often are. I took this invitation and ran with it. The result is, I think my readers will agree, a book that is pretty personal and direct in setting out my responses to Herzog's films, positive and negative, and my sense of how they matter. The book is organized into four longish chapters, a general introduction on images and contemporary culture, followed by chapters on nature, self-related history. The argumentative core of the book, into which my accounts of Herzog's work is woven, is most evident in two places, I think. The first is the first 12 pages of the chapter on selfhood, where, without talking about Herzog at all, I analyze the concepts of substance, subject, human being, person, and self, drawing on Aristotle, Descartes, Hegel, Heidegger, and Cavell, guided somewhat by Peter Hacker. It's a fairly breathless survey. The short bottom line here is that there is no such thing as the self. Rather, selfhood is a status concept, or selfhood is something to be achieved via the formation of a stable and secure, or at least more stable and more secure, ego, one that is connected continuously to its activity and relationships. The second crucial part, argumentative core, is the general discussion in the introduction of the problem of overcoming nihilism, or finding meaning in life, a discussion that draws most closely on Freud's Civilization and Its Discontents, but also brings into view Pierre Hadot, Hegel, Heidegger, Merleau-Ponty, and Cavell, as well as some of Herzog's own remarks. The short bottom line here is, first, that liberal, commercial, and industrial modernity both enables and inhibits the achievement of selfhood in important specific ways, and second, that art and the experience of art, in particular Herzog's films, among many other things, can play a productive role in furthering the achievement of selfhood under current cultural conditions. Liberal modernity enables the development of manifold forms of individuality, but it also threatens to overwhelm individuality with deadening industrial work, with widening social opacities, inequalities, and antagonisms, and with, via a kind of Schopenhauerian materialism, if there is such a thing, the sense that life is simply pain and suffering. These two bottom lines, the achievement of selfhood as a standing problem, and the character of liberal industrial commercial modernity in shaping possibilities of address to that problem, plus the thought that art might help, are the main thematic ideas that organize the whole book. They resonate both with Jaspers, as I have indicated, and with other figures whom I have taken up in my writing prior to this book, as my commentators have picked up on, Wittgenstein, Cavell, Kant, Hertelin, Nietzsche, and Wordsworth, among others, in various ways. About Herzog in particular, then, the main idea is that his films productively address the problem of the achievement of selfhood under the conditions of modern life. I will not talk about individual films here, but instead make only two short points. The first is the general point that I read Herzog's films as displaying a kind of courage or heroism in facing up to a problem that is, as I see it, both unsolvable with any completeness and yet addressable. Here I should mention that Francie Russell has been doing interesting and important work along similar lines on the continual and partly enabling presence of what she calls self-opacity in human life. Of course, not every Herzog film does this, addresses this condition or problem, equally well, or even, I think, successfully. But the percentage of successes is high, and at its best, Herzog's work is as good as it gets. Though, of course, there are other modes of address to this problem that are very different, that are important, too. Second, whatever courage or heroism, without triumphalism, I think, is displayed in Herzog's films, especially at their best. It is importantly leavened by irony and qualification, and it is importantly distributed or achieved among the characters, actual and fictional, on the one hand, and the director, via the editing, stylization, and gaze of the camera, on the other. Here, it might be of some help to say that, in my view, something true, similar is true of literary art in general, as our identifications are mobilized and held by both presented characters and authorial temptings. So my overall aim is to show that there is a problem of the achievement of self-image, that this problem takes a particular shape in modernity, and that Herzog's films productively address it without solving it, so that it is worthwhile to think both about and along with those films. That's enough of an introduction, and we can now hear what my commentators think.
Thank you, Professor Erdrich. I would like to invite now the first critic, Francie Russell. She's an assistant professor at Bernard College and works in areas of moral psychology, ethics, quantum Freud, and also Jen. Let's welcome Professor Francie.
So I'll just get right to it because I think my comments are a bit long. The title for my comments is The Screening and Screenable Animal. And this is a bit corny, but I'm going to start responding personally and directly by recounting my experience reading the book, as this will allow me to transition into some thoughts on film philosophy. So I began reading Richard Elkins' book in August last year during the New York City heat wave, and I often read it in public places, including the park near my apartment and even the public pool beside the East River. And I would find myself intellectually reflecting on Eldridge's stirring and exhilarating work while perceptually reflecting on scenes of urban life and the urbanized natural environment as they played out in front of me. In The Pleasure of the Text, Barthes writes, "The text produces in me the best pleasure if in reading it, I am led to look up often, to listen to something else." That is, the best texts prompt reflection, and so they prompt us to look away from the text itself. Eldridge's text describes Herzog as a filmmaker dedicated to finding, framing, and producing images of the world that command our attention, and in so doing, these images prompt us to see our own world, the very world he screens, somehow anew. So as I read Eldridge's text about film, I was not only led to look up often, I was also primed to see the world in front of me, cinematically, as if on a movie screening, as precisely a scene. One of the pleasures of a text about film is that it generates a cinematic form of thinking, or more accurately, a cinematic form of perceiving. Now consider something Bazin wrote in an effort to clarify the difference between cinema and painting. Bazin writes, unlike painting, what the screen shows us seems to be part of something prolonged indefinitely into the universe. That is, the screen is a frame of the material world. What it shows us is continuous with the world or universe that we in fact inhabit. And yet notice that we can also extend and reverse Bazin's claim. What the screen shows us is part of something prolonged into the world, and at the same time, our sensory experience of the world is the experience of something potentially screened. Reading Eldridge reading Herzog allows for a deeper appreciation of this fact, namely, that as a technology, an art form, as a practice, hence a life form, cinema reveals the world to be essentially screenable, or cinematic. Cinema shows the world to be cinematic. It reveals the world to be ready all by itself, to be captured by a camera and projected on a screen and viewed by an audience. And the practice of moviegoing reveals how ready we human beings are to be captured by such screens. We are a screening and screenable animal. These days, the relentless screenability of human life and our fixation with screens is usually discussed with great anxiety, and Eldridge quotes Herzog himself posting these anxieties. And yet successful cinema and successful writing about cinema remind us of this uncanny ontological continuity of the world on screen with the world we inhabit, where such reflection generates not or not only anxiety, but wonder, and is an occasion for a meaningful and opaque form of self-relation, a kind of anthropological self-knowledge or thoughtfulness about what the human being is given its attraction to screen. This is no doubt the real source of our contemporary anxiety. The real anxiety arises not from a worry about a detached and human technology taking over human life. It rather arises as we realize the depth of our investment in and ravenous attraction to screens, the fact that they tap into something very old and rooted in us. There's something deeply, unsettlingly human about screens. They are not alien to our form of life. Richard's book helped me see Herzog's Oeuvre as a whole as fundamentally oriented by this awe, by a sense of human life and the natural world as deeply, essentially cinematic. And I'll just say that I think that whatever film philosophy is, it does have to get to the level of making some kind of ontological claim about the nature of film. These insights about screenability sit uneasily with another of Eldridge's central claims, namely that Herzog is primarily interested in opportunities for authentic selfhood or the achievement of authentic selfhood. Or that Herzog's films involve, quote, somehow finding a stance that yields meaningful orientation in life in a self-sustaining way against the grain of commercial and consumptive business as usual. So I worry that this emphasis on authenticity obscures what to me are Herzog's more challenging insights about cinema and about human beings. I also find that it obscures his humor and the campiness of his films, which is one of the things I like best about them. One way to put this is that while Herzog is clearly interested in existentially harrowing images, I'm not sure this means he is interested in existentially harrowing individuals or strivings for authenticity. So consider what Eldridge refers to as Herzog's formal stylization. Here, as Eldridge observes, narrative cinema's preoccupation with plot and psychology is eschewed in favor of a more emphatically aesthetic orientation. But to my mind, what such stylizations bring forth are precisely the elements of human life that do not have to do with questions of authenticity and commitment and selfhood. Eldridge's interest in authenticity seems to me most tenuous when applied to Nosferatu. Eldridge claims that in the film, vampirism, quote, represents a release from stultifying ordinary life, and that the argument of the film seems to be that the distinctively human, inexplicable, essentially intermingled powers of sexual desire, fantasy, and meaning-making cannot be readily housed within the routines of ordinary life, if at all. While I agree with the sentiment, I felt that it was not the right lens for the film. I see instead, in this film, an exploration of the aesthetic possibilities afforded by both the practice of homage and the constraints of genre. I see meticulously constructed shots and emphasizing the structural aesthetic dimension of human interactions and the shared aesthetic standing of humans and inanimate objects. I also see great humor in Kinski's portrayal of Dracula as morose and tortured and as witheringly short-tempered as he shoves away the affectionate and creaturely Renfield. And finally, there is Isabelle Angy in turns flat and histrionic, bringing a nearly operatic and certainly campy tenor to the film. But for all of these reasons, it wasn't apt to read this film through the lens of authenticity. My worry was that such a reading domesticates the film within a humanistic framework that it turns out to be such a pleasure to leave behind. So here we might think of art or cinema as an opportunity to be at least slightly or momentarily relieved of the imperative to achieve selfhood. And so my final question, even though it's probably only of limited use to consult filmmakers in order to understand their films, I do see the frankly masculine grandiosity and self-satisfaction that Herzog articulates in his interviews to be on display in both the form and content of his more representative films like Aguirre's Geraldo. And so here's my puzzle. That I frequently do not often like Herzog's films, and yet so liked and learned from Richard's book, made me wonder if I was missing something that is there to be seen. And if that's so, have I made an error of aesthetic judgment about these films? Or have I seen exactly what's there to be seen and appreciated, and yet as a matter of contingent preference, I happen not to like it? I think the position I find myself in with Herzog after reading Eldridge's book is something that I think Kant describes as impossible, namely one of granting the legitimacy of the aesthetic testimony of another, and yet finding myself unable to share that assessment. I'm also perhaps offering a comment about my preferences, about what I find agreeable. But Kant says, quote, many things may be agreeable to a person, no one cares about that. unquote. So I'd be curious if Richard has thoughts about judgments of taste versus preference and how they intermingle when it comes to any work of art, but especially with regards to a divisive figure like Werner Herzog.
Francie Russell focuses initially on André Bazin's ideas, further articulated by Cavell, that film, or at least photographically produced, as opposed to cartoons and CGI film, captures and presents our world on screen, and that this fact has something to do with the special, medium-specific powers of photographic film as a form of art. Successful cinema and successful writing about cinema, as she puts it, remind us of this ontological continuity of the world on screen with the world we inhabit, where this is an occasion for a meaningful and opaque form of self-relation. This is a thought that I am happy to endorse, where I take it that the word opaque indicates that the work successfully invites and sustains lingering in its particular filmic densities, as opposed to focusing on a detachable message that is monitored. Herzog is a kind of master in presenting what the film scholar Daniel Jacobon calls a film world, that is, the actual world, our world, presented in a consistent, compelling, stylized way on film. This is different, by the way, from the fictional world or the story world that Ken Walton talks about. It is, rather, again, our world, captured and screened in a particular, coherent way. She then develops this thought by suggesting that, quote, Herzog's most interesting films or stretches of film orient our attention away from the quest for a meaningful, authentic life and towards the aesthetic, sensuous surface of human life, to the fact that human beings are themselves aesthetic objects and surfaces, and to the idea that human activity can be considered in terms other than those provided by psychology or narrative. I am much sure about this set of ideas. Herzog does sometimes linger on human subjects and their aesthetic presence to us, as in his tracking of Schulze's humiliations and Aguirre's manias, as indicated specifically in their surfaces, in their looks, gates, and bearing. But he also attends prominently, as Jacobon's work on film suggests, to phenomena of nature. All the flowing rapids, swirls of fog, underground ice caves, mobile sand dunes, growing grass fields, and so forth, that populate his work. I wonder whether I refer to human faces and bearings, or to natural phenomena, is in any important sense non-psychological. My sense is that the objects on which the camera lingers, both human subjects and nature, are presented as objects of and for the viewer's emotional experience, where the camera focuses as a vehicle of the director's emotionally informed attentiveness. In the case of human subjects, that attention, as I have suggested, is to such things as Strosek's humiliations, as registered in his face, gait, and bearing, and not to the latter alone. So in general, I don't see the opposition between attention to aesthetic surface and attention to psychology that Francie suggests. Francie is surely right that among Herzog's films, Nosferatu is perhaps the most highly formally stylized. In drawing on Murnau's composition in his own 1922 Nosferatu. And she is right, too, that there is some humor in Kinski's portrayal of Dracula. But why was that Murnau-esque stylization chosen? Why homage to that? Here there is, as I read it, considerable pathos in the film also. Herzog's and Kinski's Dracula seems to me to present the Heideggerian Terrorium thought that a life without death would be a life without meaning, as one could no longer ask the question, who or what shall I be, but only who or what shall I be next? As for what Francie calls Herzog's frankly masculine grandiosity and self-satisfaction, this is something I cannot deny, and there are times when I, too, am suspicious of it, perhaps especially in his autobiographical 1986 form Portrait, which is more than a little over the top. At the same time, however, there is sometimes in what she calls his masculine grandiosity and self-satisfaction also something that I think is worth admiring for both men and women. Masculinity and femininity, I take it, are more like styles of subjectivity than they are anything that is fixed by biology. What I mean is the form of courage in facing up to the ultimate unknowability of a hostile nature, and to the consequent unavailability of any clearly formed, conceptually tidy doctrine of how to do well in a life that is, inevitably, a camel ride to the tomb. A few women in the films seem to share in this courage, Juliana Kuhnke in Wings of Hope, or Karen Joyce in Encounters at the End of the World, say, though I do not doubt that as a style it is generally masculine. More importantly, that masculine style attaches to Herzog's directorial gaze in his choices of subjects, plots, and mise-en-scene. I do not expect everyone either will or should love every instance of this attention. But as one directorial style among many, and itself leavened with humor, as in the shot of the chimp riding a goat in Encounters at the End of the World, or in that film's somewhat mocking use of Ashrita Furman, it does seem to me to offer genuine resources for thinking about and responding to life intelligently and emotionally. This brings me to Frances' concluding thought, that she finds herself, with respect to Herzog, in a position, she puts it, that Kant describes as impossible, namely, one of granting the legitimacy of the aesthetic testimony of another, yet finding myself unable to share in their assessment. I do think that Kant is right about the general logic, let us call it, of impure judgments of taste about works of art as successes or failures. They are, as is well set out in a recent article on aesthetic reasons by Karen Gorodetsky and Eric Lotkin, aesthetic judgments are directions for perceiving and invitations to communion in felt response. But contra Kant's transcendental deduction of the intersubjective validity of judgments of taste, a deduction that is not clearly sound, these invitations do sometimes fail. As Eisenberg poignantly puts it, once the critic's directions for perceiving have been put forward and grasped, communion may or may not follow. The miracle is that sometimes, often enough, it does. And the disagreements and differences, the failures of communion, matter too. For they, these disagreements and differences, are ways of expressing and living our distinct individualities, as Ted Cohen argued in an important essay on critical aesthetic judgments. What matters in the end is the conversation about a wide range of works, where we can pursue and deepen possibilities of both communion and departure. I would love to watch and talk about, say, The White Diamond, Little Dieter Needs to Fly, Wings of Hope, and Strelsek with Frances, where, I imagine, we could, should, and would find both common resonances to the subjectivities presented, characterological and directorial, and interesting points of divergence and resistance. In the end, it is the game with the films, the experience of them, and the talk about how they move or fail to move us, together or differently, that is worth the camera.
On Kant's view, it isn't possible for one to disagree with others, to feel differently about something than what the common voice would suggest. And I guess I find that very puzzling, because it seemed to me that Kant's response to this would be very much like his response to the bad poet, right? You think that your poetry is great, so you think your judgments about Herzog's films are the right way, at least for you. But if you look carefully, you seem to be already acknowledging that they're only for you, and so you're not really laying claim to the common voice. Am I missing something here?
So there is a difference between judgments of the beautiful and judgments of the beautiful. That's important. The signature difference is that judgments of the beautiful, as I understand them, I think follow Kant, are supportable by reasons. But when he comes to impure judgments of taste, that is, judgments about works of art, as opposed to pure judgments of natural beauty, we can make mistakes, by the way, in judgments about natural beauty, who are distracted by our own interest in mischaracterizing the source of our own pleasure. What happens with judgments of artistic success, impure judgments of taste, is that those judgments are marked by disagreement all the time, quite obviously. They are open to what Kant in the solution to the antinomy of taste calls argument but not resolution by proofs, or opens to streiten but not disputere.
I agree with you that my interest in the more aesthetic dimensions of the film and the more psychological issues need not be opposed to one another, most certainly. I think it was a certain narrative psychology based on beliefs and desires for thinking about the characters that I felt was not the right way, and perhaps I was incorporating that into your way of thinking about authenticity too rather.
Yeah, no, I'm equally interested in the subjectivity that's developed in the screen and how the camera is used.
Dr. John Baker, since 1998, has been actively engaged academically at the School of Critical Studies, University of the Arts, Philadelphia, in different capacities, and is now professor emeritus. Going to present his response, Eldridge on Herzog, a late romantic? Question mark. Let's welcome Dr. Baker.
Herzog's hybrid oeuvre presents a large critical challenge that, to my mind, Richard Eldridge addresses by taking a broad approach, broad topical approach to the films. The image and contemporary culture, self, nature, and history. He reads the films then in a recurring manner. He does not read them one by one. He does not devote a large discussion to any single film. He periodically recurs to the films as he discusses, as he contextualizes them inside these four broad topics. I have a question here about Professor Eldridge's procedure, because next to that declared method, I saw a second undeclared method at work. That second undeclared method consisted in the way that he kept recurring to a constellation of motifs, among which are the following: ecstatic time, the fragment and fragmentariness. Anomie, he uses that word once, but I see anomie in his reflections on his periodic reflections on the problem of late capitalist economics and culture. The others are others that struck me are the sublime, a word which, interestingly, he avoided in his discussion. And I actually have a question as to why he avoided it. I recall you using the word once as such. Also, the uncanny, which I'm not sure was ever actually used, but which I see being described, being articulated, and it's certainly a component of Herzog's film. So what I'm saying here is I see two approaches that Richard took, a declared one and an undeclared one. And I wonder whether the undeclared approach, proceeding through the constellation of motifs, does not actually go more directly to the heart of Herzog's filmmaking. The second point that I want to make is that the way in which Richard ties Herzog's films back to Romanticism. First of all, I'm in favor of this. I think that there is absolutely something pertinent about that. But I did have reservations about sources he used in Romanticism and the way it is, and the way that Herzog is pinned back to Romanticism. First, the sources. There's a lot of humor in Herzog's film. That humor is grotesque at times. At times it's picaresque. And I didn't think that that was sufficiently highlighted in the book. That is related to the way in which he's tied back to Romanticism. figure like E.T.A. Hoffmann, for example, I think is highly relevant to Herzog's film world. Precisely because of E.T.A. Hoffmann's humor, precisely because of the grotesque element in E.T.A. Hoffmann. The second issue here is the use of Wordsworth, about which I suspect Richard and I may have some substantive disagreements. My particular concern there is with the use of Wordsworth and the spot of time, or the arresting moment. Richard puts a lot of emphasis on these moments in Herzog's films that can be abstracted from the film narrative. Now, that in itself I see as a certain problem, because these individual moments then become the signature of the entire film. And the whole film trajectory is forgotten. A similar thing actually happens with William Wordsworth himself, that we read these key passages, these ecstatic moments, as the signatures of the work, and one forgets what the entire narrative trajectory is. My philosophical concern there is that the signature of Wordsworth's poetry is, I would say, the future perfect. What I mean by that is those ecstatic moments in Wordsworth, they are pledges, they are promises of something that will continue to be future perfect. It will have been as it once was. And I don't see that as something that describes Herzog's filmmaking. I don't see it as something that coincides with the kind of film narratives he produces and his treatments of the figures in the film as subjectivities. I do see a figure, as I relate in the paper that I wrote, a figure like the Italian Leopardi being much closer to Herzog within the Romantic era, precisely because Leopardi is a materialist atheist. Leopardi is a poet who understands the blandishment of nature, and Leopardi is a poet who understands that nature does not support, that nature does not fulfill the kinds of subjective longings that the human subject brings to it. The third, and I'll close with this, the third thing that I wanted to raise a question about is the polemic against late modernity. And this takes us back to, I think, the matter of the sublime. I pointed out in the remarks that I presented in writing that Karl Marx already observed the coincidence between modern culture and capitalism. That perception was picked up and strongly underlined later by Jean-François Lyotard, who pointed out correctly, I think, that there are important coincidences between capitalism and specifically sublime art. That is the emphasis upon the idea, the emphasis upon extreme forms of experimentation, the emphasis upon experimentation with new kinds of materials, expanding the field apart, as capitalism indeed, on our one hand, argue against us, has expanded the field of culture in many ways. And I'll stop.
Well, this is going to be tricky. What I know and you don't is that Jay Baker wrote 30 pages on one book, which were terrific, and he's managed to summarize some of them pretty effectively, but not all of them. And I will try to adapt what I've written in response to those 30 pages partly to what he said to us now, so we can at least be intelligent to one another. The two preliminary points, that the second mode of attention, or the undercurrent, is consisting in a constellation of motifs that I find on the films, involving the uncanny, alien, the sublime, and late capitalism, might overwhelm or displace the organizing seeds of nature, selfhood, and history. My thought there is I don't see the opposition there. I think Amy and experiences of the uncanny and the sublime are experiences that arise in particular ways in late capitalism for human subjects who are embedded in nature and history. So I don't see opposition. I think you're getting right the fine texture of how I'm playing out those things and noting these motifs. Second, and most simply, yes, we do have a big disagreement. It is, for me, not a prophet of a future perfect, but a prophet who is always trying to attain doctrinal closure in a sense that life all makes sense, but never quite gets there. Jay Baker ends his extraordinarily detailed, apt, and insightful response to my book by commenting on the seemingly endless patience that Herzog brings to his work. That's not something he mentioned in his summary. That he sees it in a thought I entirely endorse, marks that work as other and more than simply the presentation of isolated moments of disruption and ecstatic sublimity. I could not ask for a better summary of that work than the one he presents on pages 6 and 7, as he distills what counts for me as essential aspects of the romantic philosophy of selfhood, nature, and God. There are equally apt passages on my view of art and of Herzog's films at their best, as instances of, stealing a phrase from Fred Rush on Schlegel, of Wechselerbots, or rotational self-proving, on the movement of both epiphany and counter-epiphany, or of disclosure and qualification, via either objective humor or a turn away from plot and closure. I could not ask for a more sensitive and responsive reading of my book. But Baker also raises some important worries that deserve a response. Return to skipping some now. He gets right my reading of the concluding scenes of The White Diamond as turning our view back to the human actors, in particular to Graham Darlington and Mark Anthony Yap, who are experiencing the circling of the swifts around the waterfall, and to ourselves, who are experiencing that same circling through the camera's attentions. That is, to pick up on Francie's remarks, seeing something happening in the real world that the characters in the film are also seeing. Not to what Baker calls a potential future scene from which the human is totally absent. That is, my reading of this scene is closer to a Wordsworthian sublime, the function of which is to elevate and energize the human subject via the unleashing of imagination from the common, than to a Leotardi and surely disruptive sublime. It's important here, however, that this Wordsworthian sublime, or what Jeffrey Hartman in his reading of Wordsworth calls the moment of apocalypse, is also balanced and qualified by moments of what Hartman calls akedah, or rebinding to the earth. Human life, as I see it, following Wordsworth and Herbert, is lived amid alternating moments of apocalypse and akedah, of selfhood and love, without any final resolution of these alternations being in view. The question for us is how we are to live with and within them, not what the world might be like in the absence of the human. I fully accept the thought that Baker later introduces that moments of disruptive sublimity are not everything in life, in art, or in Herzog. Yes, the bubbles, balloons, and champagne glasses in The White Diamond are ironically humorous, and Stefan Pashoff in Encounters at the End of the World is treated with some ironic humor, rather than simply being Herzog's method. Just as Hegel described objective humor, these are important moments of rebinding the common. Finally, Baker worries that I present what he calls a Schillerian vision of late modern culture in terms of repressed, latent, or estranged recovered powers. That's true, I do have. That, he adds, will not hold up under scrutiny by a critical anthropology or philosophy, in virtue of, still quoting him, overlooking the problem of mediation, its recommendation of an application model of cultural reform that does not meet the complexities and contradictions of modern culture. As you might imagine, I have a lot to say about this. The first thing is that I take myself to be far closer to the cannier, more realist, less naive Schiller, unnaive and sentimental, than to the more optimistic, though self-contradictory, Schiller of the letters, and of the sometime thought that beauty can save it. My play Briette is for heightened tenderness and conversation about complexities and contradictions, not for overcoming them or for ultimate salvation. This heightened attentiveness and conversation can and should, in my view, inform and figure in daily practice on the ground. So there is a kind of modest salvation from alienation and depression in you. But achieving that modest salvation is more an ongoing and incomplete process than it is a matter of achieving a final condition. As we continue to live within alternations of apocalypse and akeda, selfhood and love, Herzog, I think, in the persistence of his attentions to possibilities of heightened attention, and in his offering to us films that are worth talking about, of films, or many of them, that do fulfill the criteria of art, gives us materials with which to continue to resist cynicism and despair. He doesn't give us an ultimate solution or a recipe, any more than Wordsworth. In the end, I am all with Baker in thinking that resoluteness or persistence, the Harlish type in German, within alternations, complexities, and contradictions, and within attentiveness to them, is the best, most human way we have of knowing how to belong.
As I see it, these moments in Wordsworth are typically unannounced, making it impossible for the actual individual to make a pledge. It's rather that at some later stage they will seem somehow crucial and the keys to understanding. Understanding which is, and I agree I think with Richard here, promised but is always in some sense incomplete and frustrated. And so I guess it seems to me that when I'm thinking, unless I'm thinking of the wrong moments in Wordsworth, these are things that come later as, on reflection, the poet or the individual is seeking greater understanding, and they seem as though they will open the way for him to see into the life of things. But of course, that is ultimately unrecapturable and ultimately falls short. So that's, I think, that's different from what Richard said in reply to you, and I wonder whether you could join issues about exactly how we have to understand.
I understand Richard's reading of Wordsworth, and although it may sound hypocritical, I'm not disputing it. I made remarks I made about Wordsworth, and I entered Leopardi's name in this discussion as a provocation. I would make the following remarks. Yes, I may have overstated the sense of finality, the firm sense of teleology in Wordsworth. Nevertheless, I do think that there is an element of trust, that there is a strong element of hope in the future, that I have trouble, a great trouble, I don't even have trouble finding in Herzog's films. I simply don't think that it's there. I guess we finally do disagree about the conclusion of the White Dove. I give a different reading of the ending of that film. I do see it as pointing to a time without thinking, or, you know, in Leotard's terms, to an inhuman landscape.
I do agree there's some sense of nature absolutely exceeding the human, of what Berlin calls the absolute, the whole of nature being occluded from our grasp of it. So maybe we could talk about this more. We might not be so far from this.
Thank you very much. Dr. Prager is a professor of German and film studies at the University of Missouri. His area of research includes Holocaust studies, film history, contemporary German cinema and art, Dr. Prager will address some risks may be necessary.
In Richard Eldridge's excellent readable study, Werner Herzog, Filmmaker and Philosopher, the author provides an analysis of how Werner Herzog's films express the struggle for meaningful life, how they correspond to a Faustian striving, in industrial society, which in this case is a world as described and critiqued by a number of philosophers, of whom Martin Heidegger is among the most prominently represented. For purposes of comparison, one might recall how Andreas Daskowski wrote about Aguirre, the Wrath of God, 30 years ago in 1988, after summarizing Heidegger's standpoint that being always exists in a world in an historical mode of social existence, Staszkowski explains, quote, Herzog's project is to reveal the world as a world. In Aguirre, he reveals the way of being within the cultural conceptual framework of a particular world. Staszkowski adds that Herzog depicts a sense of being in the world in order to critique our contemporary world, and she concludes that Aguirre's narrative structure, quote, discloses a condition. Herzog's achievement is the depiction of the conditions of beings in the world of nature and in the world of their creation. He invites us to extend that insight into an understanding of our own way of being in the world. In quoting Staszkowski, my point is not to show that she was already examining this set of questions in the 1980s, but rather to reflect on whether one needs to study the entire body of Herzog's work in order to draw these conclusions. Staszkowski was looking solely at Aguirre, one of Herzog's earliest feature films. Anyone who writes on Werner Herzog today knows that they must contend with how to approach the question of his lengthy and extensive authorship. Herzog has been making films since he was very young. Born in 1942, he started making films in the early 1960s, and his filmography now contains no less than 70 titles. This is a large body of work to examine, even if one opts not to dive deeply into the well of interviews, diaries, essays, and other forms of self-expression. Can anything be gained by examining Herzog's films independent of one another? I'll return to this question of authorship later, but to speak briefly about the connection with Heidegger, it is perhaps a result of the constant confrontations with death, because of Herzog's death metaphysics, that we find so much overlap between Herzog's work and Heideggerian rhetoric. Comparisons with Heidegger are among the most complex and worrisome insofar as many different Heideggers are available to readers. Heidegger, of course, always aimed to present his own philosophy as disinterested, arguing that he offered a mere description of Dasein, a straightforward account of being in the world, but his descriptions of being are rarely as neutral as he purported them to be. Being in time is, of course, prescriptive. It is normative when it comes to authenticity and especially historicity, and even more evidence in this direction has come to light in view of the publication of the Black Notebooks, which made his anti-Semitic tendencies even clearer than they had been. As is by now well known, Heidegger believed some among us were more open to the historicity of being than others, and some not at all. One can thus interpret Herzog's films in light of the many possible Heideggers. Stephen Fogel's insights, which were published in 1988 alongside Staszkowski's, expressed arguments similar to Staszkowski and to Eldridge. The insights into Even Dwarf Started Small, The Great Ecstasy of the Woodcarver Steiner, and The Enigma of Caspar Hauser are pertinent. Fogel writes, quote, for Herzog, being unable to fit into the world is not a condition that makes it possible to understand what being human is like. Fogel goes on, as a Heideggerian filmmaker-philosopher, his Herzog, Fogel's Herzog, is the representative voice of a calculated bleakness. He is the proponent of a Schopenhauer-like pessimism, one that knows no history beyond the world into which every one of us, we, are thrown. Fogel's work represents one side of a coin, whereas Gertrud Koch and Eric Rentschler represent another. For Koch, writing in 1986, Herzog's Heideggerianism is dangerous insofar as it relies on a poetic reduction or a neo-romantic regression. Rentschler goes even farther, critiquing the authoritarian style in Herzog's productions, finding his anti-Brechtian values, particularly during the production of Heart of Glass, consistent with other expressions of authoritarianism. These essays constituted a breakthrough in considering Herzog's politics of authenticity, and they are especially important if one is concerned about the aphoristic and universalizing tendencies that suffuse Heidegger's work. Writing about the deconcealing he looks for in Herzog's films, Eldridge quotes Heidegger, "The resoluteness intended in Being and Time is not the deliberate action of a subject, but the opening up of a human being out of its captivity in that which is to the openness of being." Yet Heidegger's descriptions along these lines were rarely neutral. And whether we speak of his aesthetics or his critiques of modernity, such descriptions bring a problematic history with them, the least problematic of which concerns their pre-modern or authoritarian inclinations. How can we apply Heidegger without importing this range of issues and concerns? The second risk with which I am concerned, or to borrow from John Davidson, the other snare in the road, has to do with how one relates to Herzog's messianism, the salvation myths he sometimes perpetuates, and the discourse on the miraculous nature of his art. Without a doubt, Herzog was ahead of his time in offering insights into the era of the Anthropocene. He has had a career-long fascination dating from Fata Morgana, 1969, to The Wild Blue Yonder, 2005, with envisioning humanity's end and with a type of science fiction that looks back to an age before ours in order to find clues about what is to come. Such observations were ahead of his time, yet they hardly make him prophetic. That much, that Herzog stages himself as a prophet, is a matter of self-stylization. If one were to read this tendency against the grain as one should, then how might we couch related elements of Eldridge's standpoint? He writes, quote, "It will require a particular courage and resoluteness to seek out and respond to such achievements and defeats of selfhood, and to do so without fantasy, sentimentality, narcissistic projection, or in the end despair. In the risks it takes, and in the ranges of frequent spectacular artistic success, as well as sometimes failure, Herzog's work displays in full measure this kind of courage and resoluteness." Herzog, in such readings, becomes an apostle. I believe that the position of this sort calls for clarity. Is it the work, the entire body of films, or the man to whom we attribute this resoluteness? If we mean the man, then a position of this sort is problematic. If we mean the work, then is it the individual films, or is it all of them? When asking which of Herzog's films achieve the miracle of art, should we treat this as a logical fallacy, or is it at least a loaded question? A final concern has to do with the decontextualization that follows from the Heideggerian readings, from the existential interpretations that are arguably isolated from histories and contexts. Eldridge wisely summarizes his interlocutor's counterposition, quote, "In general, the criticism is that Herzog, via his excessive aesthetic stylizations in his films, avoids actual history, especially real political and social history, and has no sense of ordinary life. He attempts to forward, via symbolization, a pre-modern salvation myth that makes no contact with life as it is actually lived." This is the argument of a straw man, and yet I tend to agree with it. Examples of reading the films in light of life, quote, as it is actually lived, include John Davidson's study of Herzog's middle period documentaries, seen as reflections on U.S. history and ideology, or Erica Carter's insights into Herzog's African Sublime. One might, for purposes of comparison, look to Wolfgang Fischer's recent film Styx, in which a German doctor attempting to sail from Gibraltar to the island of Ascension comes across an overloaded boat full of refugees and is forced to reckon with Europe's contemporary immigration politics in light of the limits of her empathies and her needs for self-preservation. One has a better chance of contending with such issues when watching Fischer's film than Herzog's Queen of the Desert, a film that will have an afterlife owing to its place in Herzog's extensive body of work. As to which is the more philosophical film, that is, which of the two is more devoted to the study of the fundamental nature of knowledge, reality, and existence, there's really no contest.
Brad Prager raises the question, how seriously should we take artists' largely post-hoc characterizations of the meanings of their works? In particular, do Herzog's voluminous, staged, and stylized remarks about his films constitute a tar baby that attaches to our thought and produces misunderstandings? I offer a general response to this. The primary uses of the verb intend are to describe plans for the future where there is some uncertainty about whether the plans will come off, and to qualify, explain, or partially excuse what one did in the past, as in, I intended to feed the cat, but I forgot. An intention, as J.L. Austin helped us to see, is not any sort of introspectable object in mind. rather intentionally, unintentionally, and their cousins, are style of performance adverbs. If this is right, then it would be a mistake even to consider Herzog's remarks about his own work as reports on some introspectable something that existed prior to the appearance of the work itself. Of course, Herzog canon does say things like, I planned to do X, but Y happened, so I did Z instead. And I planned to do X, faced some difficulties, and then succeeded in doing X. But these plans are formed within a temporally sustained practice of filmmaking. They are subject to ongoing modification, and they are variably more or less well fulfilled in the work. Works of art, including films, are intentionally made things. The so-called intentionalist fallacy is itself a fallacy. It makes no sense even to try to interpret a film or any other work of art as just a structure. Making a film requires considerable planning, and as I have just said, Herzog can report on that planning and how it went. But they are not evidentially privileged reports on fully formed states of mind that are dispositive for a work's meaning. It follows, then, that we should read what Herzog or any other artist has to say about his own artistic, and we should take what he says seriously, just as we would the efforts of qualification, justification, exculpation, and so forth of any other agent. But as with any other agent, we must look and see for ourselves what was done and whether the agent's report is reliable. We must test Herzog's account of what he was up to against the film itself. Letting film and account shed light on each other and noting and resolving conflicts where we can and must. Should we then, as Prager asks, attribute courage and resoluteness to the man so that Herzog becomes a dangerous apostle, to the films, all of them, or to some of them? My answer is, to some films that were made by the man, and I hope my book goes some distance towards sorting out which. Aguirre, Strosek, The White Diamond, and Little Dieter, for example, yes, their achievements. But not The Wild Blue Yonder, Queen of the Desert, Salt and Fire, or even Fitzcarraldo. This position about intentions applies as well to the issue of how to read Heidegger. Yes, the Black Notebooks did make his anti-Semitic tendencies more evident than they had been before, and in my view, this should affect our reading of Being and Time. Indeed, while citing approvingly and drawing on Heidegger's general understanding of human being in the world, I also, in this Herzog book, call Heidegger's accounts of how to achieve resoluteness, quote, distressingly empty and hence open to appropriation by decisionist fascism, citing disapproving his remark about, I recall, the nation returning to itself for the fulfillment of its historical destiny. So my way of using Heidegger is to accept his anti-dualism, his sense of the occlusion of the absolute or the whole from our conceptual grasp of it, and his sense of our being thrown into a world with others that is not what it might better be, but to look elsewhere, for example, to Herzog, for better models of the achievement of resoluteness. Or, in some of my own work on Hertelen, I have actually looked exactly where Heidegger looked, but found very different things. In my understanding of Hertelen, deeply shaped by the work of Dieter Henrich, Hertelen, like Wordsworth, is a poet of anxiety and indigence, much more than he is a confident prophet of a Germanic world to come. So I think Prager is exactly right when he cites Stephen Vogel's remarks that Caspar Hauser is not a prophet come to describe the human condition. His is the human situation in all its pain, loneliness, and childlike sincerity. And that Steiner's, the woodcarver Steiner's despair, is not a despair of being in a world which had this or that form of social organization. As I understand it, accession into self-consciousness, ego formation, language, and the symbolic order is, per se, a fall into separateness and isolation, at least in part, as the props of our affections are removed. The final issue Prager raises is whether one might do better to pay attention to very different sorts of documentaries that are more genuinely historical and attentive to political and ethnic differences than Herzog's stylizations are, for example, to Wolfgang Fischer's film, Styx. My answer is that of course we should pay attention to such work along with Herzog's. That is, I did not mean anywhere to suggest that Herzog's films were a unique and self-sufficient source of morally and politically sufficient self-understanding. For me, his films occupy an important place, but just one place, in a broad and contested field of artistic and historical objects, attentions to which might enrich our self-understandings, but never perfect them. To put my claim on Herzog's behalf another way, I was reminded by Prager's urging of the importance of Wolfgang Fischer's film over Herzog's documentaries, of a moment in François Truffaut's 1973 Day for Night, where two evidently vapid German actresses who've been brought to visit the set where the director, Ferron, is shooting, meet Pamela, ask him respectively, why don't you make political films? Why don't you make erotic films? The implication of the humor here is that these actresses' dramatic sense of how art achieves importance is misplaced, and that the film we are watching, Day for Night, has its own politics and erotics that are less obvious than overtly Germanic novels. While Herzog is dramatic, I would also make a similar point about Herzog's 1992 Lessons of Darkness in particular. This film, to me, holds up strikingly well, despite or rather in virtue of the fact that it is largely highly stylized and apocalyptic. It is worth seeing and talking about, with attention to its vision and politics, along with attention to and talk about many other very different cases, too.
I really appreciate the reply, and I know that writing a book on Herzog, I've used the metaphor, and Richard quoted it, it's the tar baby of doing that, right? So you try to hold on to it, and somehow you just get covered in it, which is all the many quotations, this huge fabric, this huge tapestry of interviews and all this other material where Herzog's telling you how to interpret the films. And I think I drew the same conclusion in my writing about Herzog that Richard, that you did, which is, that you have to use that as part of the text. But I think what I struggle with, and what I struggled with at the time, and what I still struggle with today, is the extent to which we allow ourselves to be influenced by that. That his own interpretations of his work often tend to be so self-serving, all of these things that come along with it, that you really have to work overtime in order to keep the critical apparatus going, to remind yourself to look at the films separate or independent from his beliefs about them. I think it becomes particularly tricky. I mean, you negotiate it very well, so I'm empathizing more than criticizing. But it becomes very tricky, I think, with the premise of the series, which was filmmaker as philosopher. And it's to say, hey, look, this person who's got this perspective on the world that in many ways I wouldn't agree with. I don't think I'd actually like him if I had much to do with him, despite the fact that he's an adventurous person who takes lots of risks. It's the arrogance is uncanny. And one can cite also many instances of things that he's said that are quite injudicious. And it's not for no reason that people have... that he has scaled back in recent years his interest in kind of being in a post-truth society. He used to speak much more freely about loving pro wrestling and Anna Nicole Smith, her reality TV show. She is fascinating. You have to watch this. And it's all the product of, as he says, to quote the Minnesota Declaration, imagination, stylization, fabrication. And, now I think we live in a moment where those are trickier things to champion. And I think as we look back, we have to hold up to critical scrutiny and say, what do we think about the remarks when he made them? What do we think about the remarks now? And all of that is context, rather than taking him, so to speak, at his word, or taking earnestly all of those claims about being post-truth. So I'm in the habit of subjecting his own language, his own rhetoric to critical scrutiny, and it's something that we have to continue to do. I think you really rose to the occasion with your citation of Day for Night, that the idea that one should walk up to Herzog and say, why don't you make other kinds of films, would be, hubristic and not all useless, and probably as a Kantian point, none of us would want us to have artists do the work that we would want them to do. We would want artists to, I say that as a form of categorical imperative, we would want the artists to basically do what they do and feel comfortable doing. So I wouldn't tell Herzog to make other kinds of films. I just think that we have to bear in mind when we think about authorship, and the image, the specter of authorship is so profound when it comes to Herzog, I mean, that is just, his image overwhelms the film, that you look at it and say, why do we spend time looking at my son, what have you done, or Queen of the Desert, or that Bad Lieutenant, so to speak, homage, remake, whatever it was, that these are not great works. What they tell us something about is something ideologically in the moment that they were made. Or maybe they say something interesting about Nicolas Cage as a performer. Or, there, I mean, there are ways in which, yes, they are interesting, but to treat them philosophically, one runs into problems about what kind of object am I dealing with when I treat these things philosophically. You make a distinction between the good and bad works, more or less, in your sentence. You're right, these were made by, which works were made by Herzog, which works were made by the man. And Aguirre, Strozek, White Diamond, and Little Dieter are the good ones, while Blue Yonder, Salt and Fire, and even Fitzcarraldo are not as strong. I think that's something that maybe it's worth, you know, as a group, thinking through what does it mean to have a division, especially when you're going to look at the works of an auteur, between the good and the bad works. I mean, aren't they all somehow expressions? Just some are failures, but we look maybe at the failures with the same eyes that we look at the successes. So that'd be all the thoughts. I mean, thank you very much for the thoughtful reply. I look forward to more discussion.
One of the ways, I think, to avoid, because you brought up Heidegger, and I haven't read the book, unfortunately, but brought up Heidegger and how different Heideggerian concepts can be used to interpret Herzog's films and whatnot. But I think one way to avoid that, avoid the risk of having to deal with Heidegger's fascism and anti-Semitism, is to look at Jaspers, who actually developed a lot of those concepts before Heidegger. And so in fact, I only caught a little bit of the question from the last paper, but the concept of transcendence was mentioned, for example. And I think in Jasper's 1919 works, Psychology of Worldviews, he identifies four limit situations. So things like death, guilt, suffering, and I can't really remember the other one. And he says, you know, people are always running up against these things. And we start developing our own sort of subjectivity in relation to these universal structures which hem in which affect every human being. And so I think you can avoid sort of the Heideggerian dilemma by going to Jaspers and saying, well, he has these concepts here as well. I've only seen a couple Herzog films, but in the ones I have seen, I sort of notice these Jaspersian themes really strongly. So for example, I think it's The Grizzly Man, is that one? So where main guy, he's really confronted by the sense of I don't know if it's guilt or obligation to protect these grizzly bears, and going to the extreme, and then not being able to reach the absolute or transcendence, and then foundering and ultimately dying. So those are very Jaspersian themes. I don't know if you have any comments.
Yeah, I'll make just a couple of comments. I mean, first, just a clarification that talking about tarring someone with a brush, I didn't mean to imply that the book is really that Heideggerian. I mean, Heidegger's one of a number of figures, and I really overemphasize that in my paper, and Richard was very gracious in not, hitting back and saying the book is not Heidegger and Herzog. So fair enough, so just to clarify that. The other point, so there's, you know, a couple different ways I think of Jaspers here. The connection with, as you said, the trio of death, guilt, and suffering, that there's, obviously one could use him to think about Herzog for all the same reasons one uses Heidegger to think about Herzog. It's the confrontation with death, and that's why Heidegger is such an appealing character when one thinks about Herzog's films. The things that people tend to parody when we think of Werner Herzog, right? The speech from Burden of Dreams, which is, you know, I listen to the jungle and I hear only the sounds of fornication and murder, or what, you know, I mean, it's this, or it's he doesn't say murder in that one, but it's death and fornication, right? And then in Grizzly Man, it's probably the sequence you remember, when he looks into the face of the bear and sees murder. And so, I mean, one, it's that confrontation, it's, you know, being towards death. And I think you could go back just as easily, or maybe even with more benefit, to look at Jasper's existentialism and say, why not use these tools rather than the Heideggerian ones, would be an interesting question. The second way to think about Jaspers there is, of course, the question of German guilt, late Jaspers after the war. And that's a really interesting question. Some people have explored it with Herzog, you know, some more, some less. But the idea that he is in some ways avoiding dealing with the question of German guilt, he has very few films that deal with that. I mean, a body of work from a new German cinema filmmaker born during World War II, who's made over 70 films, and very few touch on the question of German guilt.
Heidegger has appropriated a lot of the culture of Weimar, even though he was fundamentally opposed to it. But he, and his response to Jaspers' book on worldviews, a response that he sent to three people, including Jaspers' arch enemy Heinrich Rickert, with the remark that these views are provocative, but they need to be confronted head on. This is at the same time that he was professing a kind of professional, at least, friendship with Jaspers. So Heidegger, in retrospect, has sort of reformulated, and he's come to have this status within academia, right? There are all these Heidegger defenders who show how it's all philosophically really sophisticated despite the Nazism. And then they'll say, well, somebody like Jaspers really isn't philosophically as sophisticated. They'll look at the early works of Jaspers when he was transitioning from being a psychiatrist to becoming a philosopher, and completely ignore everything that he wrote later on. But my point is actually that in Jaspers you have something that's much more interestingly relevant to, I think, Herzog, which is exploring the way you come up against these psychopathologies and limit situations as you're attempting to come to terms with day-to-day life. And I suspect that this is, in some respects, in Herzog, an attempt to come to terms with the normalized Germany of the post-war period, when there was this effort to sort of leave the horrors of Nazism behind. And what Herzog does is he's continually showing, just as the Romantics and the Expressionists do, that the uncanny, these limit situations pop up even when we try to suppress them. So he's not really so much vindicating some kind of romantic dream, which I don't think is romantic anyway, as pointing out that there you can't avoid this struggle for a kind of failed transcendence.
About Herzog's work in particular, the only thing I have to say on this point is I do think there is a combination in Herzog, repression or evasion of repression of responsibility and guilt, coupled with a kind of indirect address to it. So stylistically, he contrasts his films together, actually, with Fassbinder and Benders as the first real German films that were made after World War II. What's the antonym to that? The antonym to that are Karl Lai films and Heimat films, the stuff that was typically on television during his childhood.
Dr. Verena Key teaches in the Department of German at Georgetown University. She received her PhD in Germanics from the University of Washington in 2019. In her book project, she examines how an array of photo books reused previously published images and text to specifically address workers, soldiers, and women, casting these three social groups as counterpublics. An article related to this research has recently been published in the Journal of German Language and Literature. Thank you for being here and welcome.
At the beginning of this commentary and review, I would like to compliment Professor Aldrich on his in-depth familiarity with Herzog's oeuvre, covering almost all of his films with ease and swiftness in a clear and very accessible style. I would like to start with a very general question on the organization of the book. How did you choose the three categories of nature, self, and history? That is, did you also consider other categories, such as corporeality, as, quote, the bodily placement emerges as quite an important category in your introduction? Or did you also think about the category of viewer engagement as, quote, attention and modulated attention, and the audience's awareness of constructed images often become central aspects in the discussions throughout your entire book? So this is a general question on the organization of your book, and I will now have an array of questions and observations, and I understand that we will be able to only focus on some of them. In my comments, I will follow the structure of Professor Eldridge's book and offer observations and questions for each chapter. In the chapter on nature, you align Herzog and Nietzsche in their view of nature as being hostile to human powers. Also in other chapters, Nietzsche continues to be a consistent partner in thought for Herzog. For instance, Herzog's first line in his 24 pieces of advice reads, "Always take the initiative," which could be aligned with Nietzsche's thought, when the, quote, idea of discharging turns into the will of power. Claude Van Gogh is so far as to describe Herzog's approach to filmmaking as Nietzsche. In this chapter on nature, as in others, you often integrate and rely on Herzog's statements. Herzog is known for his self-stylization in his interviews and statements, making his views at times unreliable. Why did you choose to draw on his statement? In the case of this chapter, is it perhaps because of Herzog's personal experiences with and within nature? Or is there a distinction between his personal childhood experiences and his performance as a filmmaker in interviews? Turning from the filmmaker to the viewers, compared to issues of selfhood and history, it seems that in the case of the category of nature, viewers are left out. As you write, quote, "The experience of Herzog's images of nature includes an experience on the part of the viewer of being left outside the movement of nature, as nature relates itself to itself," end quote. Does this make the images of nature and landscapes least accessible to its viewers? That is, it seems the more constructed his images addressing selfhood and history become, the more approachable his films become to his viewers, whereas the long pans of landscapes leave out Herzog's audience. Or is this exactly the point, that the viewer cannot readily relate to nature's images, as they are too familiar with them outside of the movie theater? My last question for this chapter concerns what, as you write, worthwhile human action and nature looks like for Herzog. Regarding the white diamond, for instance, you are referring in a footnote to the discussion of the film in the chapter on history. And I was wondering if you could elaborate on this again. Also because, while not in the final chapter, but in the one on selfhood, you write that Dorrington only finds, quote, "a sense of meaningfulness by escaping life on the ground, i.e. when he flies up in the air." Does this then mean for Herzog's viewers that before any engagement with nature, a distance to it is necessary? In the beginning of your longest chapter on the topic of selfhood, you define the three concepts of substance, subject as responsive to external influences, and person as a role, norm, status concept. After reading your chapter on Herzog's visualization of the individual's struggle to fully realize its selfhood, I found myself going back to the beginning of the chapter and wondering if all individuals in Herzog's films are primarily subjects that struggle both with external influences and the actualization of their selfhood, while either not having achieved or even fully rejected personhood, not fulfilling any roles, norms, or the status of a moral being. If this is the case, does this then alter an understanding of selfhood, potentially replacing personhood in Herzog's films? As a general question for this chapter, I'm wondering, to put it simply, what Locke, Aristotle, or Hegel would have learned from Herzog's cinematic or visual philosophy and his take on selfhood. Is selfhood, this strive to experience an actualization of personal hidden powers usually visible within human beings, in the way Herzog visualizes it, an extension of Aristotle's understanding of it? Or does it remain incomparable or incompatible, as Herzog does not select, quote, "the ordinary stuff of family or commercial life," unlike Aristotle, but he selects outcasts, eccentrics, and outsiders that are tasked to make meaning in, quote, "the face of a hostile administered social world." In this chapter, you also cover Herzog's documentaries that are concerned with religion. In understanding religion as a spiritual exercise for Herzog, as it allows for a, quote, "conversion of a way of life from within a way of life," is his filmmaking essentially becoming a religious or spiritual exercise for him? Eric Ames writes that the relationship at heart in Herzog's documentaries on religious practices is between, quote, "the believer's interaction with the unseen image." Can this be applied to Herzog's interaction with the cinematic image, aiming to make his viewers see what would remain otherwise unseen by repeatedly revisiting religious subjects and his fascination with the corporeality of religious acts? In the same way as the repetitiveness of the subject's performances becomes apparent in Herzog's repeated attempts to visualize selfhood, does this turn his filmmaking also into a spiritual act? When you discuss in the second half of the chapter on selfhood, Herzog's fiction films and the self-actualization, or fail thereof, of their madmen, you write that, quote, convention and social authority, thought of as coercive and represented by language, are set in opposition to nature in internal powers of self-making. Yet, in his documentaries concerned with religion, which you discussed in the first half of the chapter, language and voice are not voices of convention and social authority, but forms of resistance to administration, be it by muteness or overabundance of speech or babble. Does that mean that the function of voice, speech, and language shifts between Herzog's documentaries and his fiction films? And if so, why would this be the case? Or put differently, is language and maybe sound in general in his films, including the often ironic or counteracting force of voiceovers and use of music, a category that lies between nature and convention, becoming a necessary connector or disruptor between these two entities? The final chapter on history starts with covering the controversies around his films that regard the representation of historical and political reality, as they often overlay, over-stylize, or even erase the actual historical and socio-economic realities depicted. Yet, as this chapter also points out, Herzog criticizes Euro-American civilization in broad terms as barbaric, not offering a solution but a potential recovery through the, quote, resentment-laden formation of the ego. And I was wondering now if you could elaborate more on what is meant here with this formation process of the ego. Your main interlocutor to frame your discussion of Herzog's understanding of history is Benjamin, and his view of history less as science but as a constructivist aesthetic remembrance. Your argument follows a movement that intertwines the film's plots and Herzog's own statements as evidence. What role do elements of cinematography, such as montage, that connects Herzog's pans and close-ups, play in these and other films? In particular, as montage influences and constructs the film's images in the same way as Benjamin's concept of history is not a simple record of what has been, but a, quote, construction whose site is not homogeneous, empty time, but time filled by now time, end quote. For instance, in Lessons of Darkness, Herzog uses an allegorical montage principle, contrasting shots of landscapes, instruments of torture, animals' remains, destroyed technology, victims, firemen, and even intertitles with each other, triggering the viewer's critical reflection and ultimately underlining an understanding of history as a constructive one. As a last question for this chapter and this commentary, I was also interested, after your analysis of Where the Green Ants Dream, Gesualdo, Death for Quiet Voices, and Cave of Forgotten Dreams, how your use of Benjamin and his view of history would apply to the films and the controversies that you mentioned in the beginning of the chapter, i.e. Ballad of the Little Soldier, Lessons of Darkness, or Fitzcarraldo. Thank you for allowing me to revisit Herzog's films from new viewpoints, and I look forward to discussing the question.
Verena Kick raises too many good questions for me even to begin to do justice to them all. I will start with the first one. Why are the main categories of my book nature, selfhood, and history? The simple answer, my opening remarks suggest, is that selfhood, as discussed in pages 99 to 111 as a role concept, is the main focus. In particular, as in my past work on art, romanticism, and language and subjectivity, I am interested in a sense that many of us have in modernity, at least sometimes, where we are somehow not satisfyingly housed within meaningful routines of life. Life seems to pass us by, or we seem to suffer it, without standing cathexis to others or to what we do. This is always a risk for any ego in its emergence via a fall into language, but it is shaped and exacerbated by modern social opacities that derive from the explosion in available social roles, an explosion itself due to the development of modern science and technology. I am interested, above all, in plights and possibilities of selfhood as a partly achievable status, involving what I have elsewhere called expressive freedom, or being at home in or connected to a considerable run of one's activities and relationships, but of course not to all of them, all of the time. Nature and history then come in because the pursuit of fuller selfhood is something that is on the books for us, essentially, as embodied beings who are thrown into a history. But otherwise, selfhood is a role into which we attempt to enter only from within our embodiment and our embeddedness within nature and history. Modulated attention and constructed images. My understanding of nature is in one way Nietzschean and in another way not. Like Nietzsche, I see nature as a self-developing whole that is without meaning or purpose, let alone a meaning or purpose that is harmonious with our human meanings and purposes. But against Nietzsche, I do not think that the primary route to overcoming nihilism and achieving cathexis is a matter primarily of passion and thonic self-affirmation, if that is the right reading of Nietzsche. Against Nietzschean nomadism and hyper-volitionalism, and more in line with Kant, I do think that some form of qualified settlement within nature and history is both possible and valuable. My models for the achievement of qualified settlement, where there are always two important possibilities of departure, even alienation, are more Wordsworth or Herderlin stopped on the bridge in Heidelberg over the Neckar than the negative ecstasies of Nietzschean opposition to the common and low. Here I do resonate with Herzog's sense of his own childhood in rural Bavaria, a childhood that he describes in astonishingly Wordsworthian terms as a matter of roaming among the mountains and villages freely and without the burdens of self-consciousness. This condition, however, cannot last, especially as we enter adolescence and become increasingly aware of the gazes of manifold, often hostile others. I have a longish passage from Tintern Abbey here, but I'll cite only the last line. That time has passed, and all its aching joys are now no more, and all its dizzy raptures. I am interested in what comes after that loss, and in how we might fruitfully or more fruitfully cope with it. Herzog's images of nature seem to me with this problem. For one thing, in Cave of Forgotten Dreams, he suggests that trafficking in images is a central way of expressing and coping with the fact of human self-reflectiveness. Because we are self-reflective beings, first by nature in virtue of our rational doingness, but then in actuality, in our Gaia, as we enter into language, we seek not merely animal satisfactions, but the satisfactions of self-consciousness, to appropriate a Hegel-derived phrase from Robert Pippin. Satisfaction, that is to say, in activity, where we also have a story about the worth of what we're doing. This is a problem and a possibility that arises only for beings who are natural, but not merely natural, or who, in Aristotelian terms, have a rational soul or set of powers, as well as a nutritive soul and a locomotive soul. Thinking about human beings as self-reflected, embodied, natural beings in this way is sharply different, I take it, from Cartesian and Lockean understandings of the human being. It is closer to Aristotle and to Hegel, but I lack their confidence that routines for the full achievement of selfhood are readily available in either Greek aristocratic male life or even in modern family life, civil society, and citizenship, for all their charms. Responses to this problem and possibility are taken up and presented in various ways in Herzog's films. There are the tragedies of Caspar Hauser, both Strosek's, and the dwarves of Even Dwarfs Started Small. Figures who are stuck in unsatisfying repetitions and subjected to violence in ways that significantly restrict their achievements of selfhood. These figures remain persons in my usage, in being human beings who are to some extent responsive to reasons, able to carry on conversations and to participate in human life. But their achievements of full cathexis to their lives are badly stunted by hostile forces. Or there are the comparative, but weird, successes of the woodcarver Steiner, Little Dieter, Juliana Kripke, and the scientists in Encounters at the End of the World and Caves of Forgotten Dreams. Or there is the sheer narcissistic madness of Aguirre. One of the most interesting and difficult thoughts that I find in Herzog, that I am prompted to by Kick's questions, and a thought that does not fully appear in my book, is that the achievement of selfhood both first requires a willingness for repetition, for doing something skillfully over and over and finding it worthwhile. But also, second, that achieving this frequently involves obsessiveness and weirdness. I am thinking here of the auctioneers and how much wood could a woodchuck chuck, of Steiner's ski jump, and of the obsessively repetitive pilgrims and ritualists who populate Herzog's documentaries on religion. A further thought to which Keck prompts me is that Herzog himself is an obsessive repetitive movie maker. At 78, he is still going strong, with three films scheduled for release soon. And in his oeuvre, he obsessively revisits certain topics, religious devotion, life in extreme places such as the Peruvian jungle or Antarctica, and figures of obsession or possession by something, such as Timothy Treadwell, Huey Rogers, and Gene Scott. This suggests, as Kip proposes, that Herzog's filmmaking is also itself a spiritual act, as he explores possibilities of repetition that embody successful sensuous meaning-making, and does so himself in a repetitive way. I think our attention is held as much by Herzog's agency and efforts as it is by the human subjects whom he explores in his work. Possibilities of success in repetitive, sensuous, medium-specific meaning-making are available in many different media of art, as I see. Herzog often suggests a contrast between the artistic significance of the successful, non-commercial image and language, which he more typically associates with convention and social authority. This opposition is indeed a prominent theme in Kaspar Hauser, among other movies. But in my view, following Hegel on the ultimately poetic or imagination and emotion-involving character of all art in any medium, and I think in the end in Herzog's view too, art is possible in language too, in the form of literary art. Herzog is himself an accomplished writer, and his main sources of inspiration include, he says, Homer, Virgil, Buchner, and Kleist. The trick in any medium of art is to solicit, sustain, and reward attention to the embodied sense-making work of the work. Herzog achieves this, wherever he does, in a variety of ways that include scripting, mise-en-scene, cinematography, editing, scoring, voiceover narration, and in plotting. Importantly, as Jay Baker writes, his editing is frequently associative rather than narrative, a matter of the time image rather than the movement image in Deleuzean terms. Though, unlike what I see as the heavy-handedness of Eisenstein, in the best cases in Herzog, the narrative thread is never quite lost. In Heart of Glass, for example, it does get pretty lost, but in Grizzly Man and Aguirre, it doesn't. As I suggested in replying to Brad Prager, Herzog's documentaries have their own politics, the politics of, as I see it, productive heightening of attention that rejects pieties of both the left and the right. Sometimes this has its costs. Sometimes we need and want more concrete and specific political analysis in art and in life. But the vision thing matters too, and that is what Herzog is getting at in Gesualdo, Cave of Forgotten Dreams, with its astonishing intercut images of the albino crocodiles and the Fred Astaire shadow dance and Lessons of Darkness. These films help us to see that our political problems and possibilities are interwoven with a more general problem of the bearing and expression of self-consciousness as beings who are thrown into nature and time.
I think what still, while I was listening to you and to everyone else, is this distinction, if there is a distinction, that you can really do in terms of language between this documentaries and narrative films. And, but this is also to do with that I mainly only engage with his documentaries. And reading your book, I was struck with, can we maybe make a real distinction between that he uses language either as an act of defiance or not?
The use of the voiceovers and of shots of itself is very prominent in many of the documentaries.
Yeah.
Surely the language he uses there is the language of his distinctive subjectivity that he must regard as attentive, somehow other than the cliches of what he other stigmatizes as the languages of advertising and so forth. So there must be some distinction to be drawn between different kinds of use of language.
When discussions of Heidegger take place, they often
come round to describing the darkly regressive trend in Heidegger's thinking, and that darkly regressive trend is then often labeled romantic escapism. So first, a clarification. I assume that you share the perception that this really has nothing to do with romanticism as we know it, romanticism with a capital R. It is rather a typification of a certain reception of romanticism in the 20th century. But then I want to attempt to save something from Heidegger. And I suspect that you do too, but you may not. You referred to the obsessive-compulsive trait of Herzog's filmmaking, and you were expressing something positive. But you also described in rich detail his use of his own childhood. You described in rich detail the deep impress of that childhood in this remote Bavarian area on his sensibility. I'm wondering whether there isn't an opening here for Heidegger. Yes, Heidegger is, for anybody who's ever read him, obsessive, compulsive, and tedious. But there is something, would you agree that there is something that Heidegger is after in these recursions to German Romanticism, among other things, that is worth hanging on to?
The answer is yes, it's there in Heidegger, in his Southwest German peasant sensibility, as it were. A sense of connection to the land, nature, the acknowledgement of temporalities extending from childhood and including falls into exteriority. I'm not sure it's as productively there in Heidegger as it is in other figures in whom I also see that being present. Notably, Wordsworth, the hurdle that helped the Desleben, so I could do a lot worse than spend a lot of time reading Help the Desleben's and related shorter lyrics and further books, or even in Proust's time of experience in childhood, experience of nature in childhood. So, yes, those tropes are there in Heidegger. And it's, I guess I don't wish to throw them away, but I don't find this particular version of development. I find it too marked by grandiosity, transcendence, and regression and escapism, in contrast to these other figures in that image.
And let's thank the author, Richard Eldridge, and the critics.